And after this, he enlisted the help of Bharata Muni, who wrote it down, and it was taken to the people. This is how we understand that there were three different pillars to the Natya Shastra itself, Nritta, Nritya, and Natya. And they together came in and sort of spoke about the meaning of Natya and how it's really essential to the Natya Shastra. So that is the basic origin story. That is how the Natya Shastra began. And after that, like I said, the presentation was made to the Lord of Dance, Nataraja himself, and he enlisted the help of Nandi to be able to add Tandava as a form of expressing the masculine energies of one's body to the dance form itself. And with that, he also took help from his wife, Parvati, who is known to be a very graceful dancer. And she added Lasya, which helps you sort of express the feminine energies, express grace in the best way possible through your dance or through your performance at all. So those were the additions that the Lord of Dance made to this entire presentation. We are all caught up. I am very sorry for the technical glitch. And interesting thing about this story is that not everything with the presentation went as smoothly as you would think. Enter the Asuras. Now, the Asuras are, we associate with them with negativity, with evil tendencies and all these sorts of things. But I wouldn't blame them if I knew the story. So what happened is that Bharata Muni decided to present this story of the Samudra Manthan. Now, Samudra Manthan is, for those who don't know, it is a fairly common story, but I will quickly run you through it. It basically translates to churning of the ocean. So what happens is that when there was a need for it, a turtle was set down with a mountain on top, and Vasuki the serpent was coiled around the mountain. And on one side, we had the Devas, and on the other side, we had the Asuras, and they were playing a sort of tug of war. They were churning the ocean using this mountain in the middle, and the snake churned around it, almost like how you churn butter, right? And the reason they were doing this is because they wanted Amrit, which is a nectar that makes you immortal, to come out of it. And decided that this is the best way to do it. So for a change, they decided to work together. And Bharata Muni shows this particular piece. And obviously, the Devas turn out to be triumphant in the story. And the Asuras see that and they're like, we reject the Natya Shastra. You can't say this about us. There's no point to this whole thing. And they get very annoyed by this. And this is when we see Brahma step in. So Brahma comes in and he says that, you see, the Natya Shastra is not about right or wrong. It's not about judging who is good and who is bad. The purpose of this particular play was to be able to show people both sides of the story. But the reality is, if there were no Asuras on one side, the Devas wouldn't have been able to churn it, and nobody would have gotten it. And if there were no Devas, the Asuras wouldn't have been able to do anything either. And if you take this for a metaphor for us, the Asuras will represent any emotion or any feelings you have that you associate with negativity, like greed or jealousy or all these sorts of things. We don't like these emotions, but the reality is that they exist in us very, very naturally. So, and with Devas, the idea of being generous, the idea of being kind, the idea of wanting to rule and having power, all is associated with the Devas. So we have both of these energies within us, just like we also have the masculine and feminine energies within us. And therefore, it is okay to make peace with both. And if a Natya has purpose to show the Rakshasas in a good light, or even to show the Asuras in a good light, it is allowed to. And that is the most interesting part of the Natya Shastra. So so if I, according to the Natya Shastra, were to perform, I can play a Rakshas, which I know most of my friends think I play anyway. I can play a serpent. I can play a court dancer. I can play a tree. I can play anything I want. And the Natya Shastra gives no bar to it. It is inclusive of all the different castes, unlike any of the other texts. It allows any caste to indulge in Natya, watch or perform or get involved with in any capacity. It allows every profession to participate in it. It allows every gender to participate in it and do whatever interpret or represent whatever they want. That's what it's all about. And what Brahma now very kindly explains to the Asuras is that there is no art, no science, no yoga, and no vritti that cannot be represented by the Natya. Now, there are some complicated terms I used here, but what he essentially is saying that there is nothing in this world, no job in this world, no dharma in this world that does not have a place within the Natya and within the Natya Shastra. So, vritti means a way of life. Now, the reason I say represent vritti and not imitate is because there is a very keen difference that Natyashastra makes between representation and imitation. What it says is that you can represent anybody's vritti or anybody's way of life without any bar being given to who they are. It's completely allowed. But when I say representation versus imitation, right? Imitation is about copy-pasting. It's just about doing exactly what you see or what exists. And representation is about understanding the essence of it and then carrying it forward. For example, if I take the task of drinking water, okay, if I were to imitate the task of drinking water, I'd, you know, struggle to open the bottle, I'd be like, fine, I drink water, I spill some on myself, I wipe it away, I'm annoyed, and then I bang the bottle down, I shut it, and my mom will yell from the background being like, you can't even drink water without making noise. And that's what imitation is all about. But representation is understanding the essence of this task. The essence is that a person feels thirsty. They feel like they need to drink water. They pick up the bottle, they pour the water into their mouth, and their thirst is quenched. They feel satisfied. That satisfaction they feel is why they're doing the task at all. And they put their bottle away. That is the difference between imitation and representation. And Natyashastra believes that there is no need for imitation at all when you can simply represent a task by understanding the essence of it. So it is open to everybody to do. It is supposed to be part of everyone's lives in whatever capacity they deem fit. And the purpose behind why you perform Natya or why you indulge in Natya is the only thing that dictates it. Not who you are, not who the character is, not what the real story is, just what you want to convey. That is what is important. Okay, now a lot of gyan has been understood about what the Natyashastra is and why it came to be, all these sorts of things. Let's get into some interesting stories. So I'm going to be talking about some Sanskrit dramas that basically were written based on the Natyashastra, and they follow all the technicalities of it. I'm going to be talking about this term called rasas. Rasas or navarasas, let me explain it to you this way. When we talk about a juice and we say ras, ras is the essence of it, right? So the essence of a person is what they feel, their sentiments. So the best translation I can offer for rasa is sentiments. So these sentiments, when I talk about them in context of these stories, they're not just for, you know, the performer or the person writing it. It's for the audience member. It's for the person who is portraying a character. It is for the person who's involved back end, everything. So rasas are basically any sentiments that a story takes you through. That's what it's all about. Quick check in before I get into this segment. Can everyone see my screen and am I audible? Is everything all right now?
Is this blank? If that's blank, meant to be
blank right now. It's suspense, guys. But till you are everything else is working all right.
Yeah.
All right. Thanks so much, yep. Guys. And sorry for that earlier glitch. Okay, so let's jump into our first story. Since we're in the mythological realm, let's start with a mythological Sanskrit drama. Okay, so we all have heard Mahabharata. We, like, you know, Ekta Kapoor has been kind enough to give her interpretation of it time and time again. So the Mahabharata is where we begin this story. It is between five brothers called Pandavas and Kauravas, who are 100 brothers, and they're fighting for a lot of the Battle of Kurukshetra. Now, here we're going to zoom into one specific battle that is fought between Bhima and Duryodhana. Bhima is from the Pandavas, Duryodhana is from the Kaurava side. Now, both of them are very, very mighty warriors, one of the best in both their sides, and they both have a specialty of Gadha Yudh. Now, Gadha Yudh, you can see the Gadha in their hands or maces. So they're indulging in this Gadha Yudh, and it's really ferocious, and they're you know, everybody is watching with bated breath to know what's going to happen because they're both so great and such an equal match for each other. But now might be a good time to tell you that Duryodhana is actually the protagonist of this story. So we are rooting for him. Duryodhana is winning this battle, and he is shown to be, as you know, bold and courageous and very you know, strong and very good at whatever he is doing, and he is fighting for his own dharma. So they're fighting, and suddenly gets this indication from Krishna, and he breaks a rule, strikes Duryodhana, and breaks his thighs. Now Duryodhana is extremely appalled. He cannot believe what is happening. And it's not because, you know, he's in pain or because he has a battle wound, but because Bhima has just broken a rule. That's not allowed. He cannot strike on the thighs like that. And he's broken his thighs. And that's where this play gets its name. It's called Urubhanga, which means the breaking of the thighs. And now he is weaponless. He is desperate. He doesn't know what to do. And slowly, almost like Vasuki, the serpent king, he rests all his weight onto his hands and he's crawling. He doesn't know what to do. He's crawling on the battlefield. His blood is everywhere. It's just spreading and he's simply crawling away from his fate. And, you know, his blood is mixing with the dirt and we just want to see it end. We want to see the suffering end. And that's when his family comes in. Now, Gandhari and Dhritarashtra have come. Gandhari is a very strong woman. She is the one who had blindfolded herself when she was newly married to a blind man because she was she wanted to show that sort of strength, and she has never looked back ever since. But the strong woman is now looking at her son in such a helpless state, and she's crying. She's inconsolable. And Duryodhana didn't feel the pain of his bleeding thighs, but he felt this pain as her son. That's when his wives and his sons walk in. His wives, also very strong women all the time, have their hair open, they're distressed. They can't see their husband like this. Husband who they worshipped and thought was a mighty warrior is fallen before them, unable to get up. And he is bleeding to death. And they're simply crying. They don't know what to do. They're asking him what has happened. They don't know what to do. And Duryodhana, he didn't feel the pain of his bleeding thighs at all. But he felt this pain as their husband. And his son, Durjoy, who probably was too young to even know what was happening, all he wanted to do was to sit in his father's lap and play with him. And he couldn't. And Duryodhana didn't feel the pain of his bleeding thighs, but he felt this pain as a father. So just as we see his family weeping over his fate this way, we see his mentor Balarama come in. Now, Balarama's favorite student of all time was Duryodhana. He really wanted to see him succeed. And he has just seen what has happened and he is infuriated. I mean, Bhima has broken a rule. It was very clear that Duryodhana was winning. So he says, I am going to go and kill all of the Pandavas. And he's saying this, mind you, despite his own brother Krishna being on the Pandava side. And Duryodhana says, you will do no such thing. Because he has come to realize how futile war is. How the problems, the calamities that war causes is not battle wounds and scars and what happens to the warrior himself, but rather what happens to the warrior as a family man, as the collateral damage that war causes, and how absolutely futile everything looks in front of all of that. So he beseeches him to stop, and Balarama calms down. Ashwatthama then comes in and says he has vowed that he is going to kill the Pandavas overnight. Even though Duryodhana tries to stop him as well, Balarama says once Ashwatthama has decided he's going to do something, he will do it. So he has to let go of that. And finally, the play closes with Duryodhana ascending the heavenly abode and getting his salvation and being at peace with the world. Now, when we first started this story, we saw these two mighty warriors just fighting it out. And we see them, you know, so rigorously in battle, completely oblivious to the world. Just you want to know who's going to win, what's going to happen next. You know, that pulsating moment when you see that war happening, that is the Veera Rasa that we feel. We can feel that in our veins. And then when we see what happened to Duryodhana and how he's crawling on the field, just trying to edge away from his destiny, blood everywhere, his blood and dirt mixing and not knowing what to do, and his legs completely useless, you feel disgusted. You just want it all to end. You're just like, please don't tell me all of this detail. That is the Bhibhatsa Rasa, when we feel that disgust. And then when his family comes in, you feel the pain they feel. You don't care about what Ekta Kapoor has told you about his stories. You don't care about everything else that you've heard about Duryodhana. You just want him to get his salvation. You want to end the suffering for his family, and you feel horrible for how they're feeling, how he's feeling for them. You feel that sympathy, that angst. That is the Karuna Rasa. And finally, when it's all over, and he is at peace with himself in the world, and he has finally ascended his heavenly abode, you feel Shantarasa. So that was Urubhanga, the breaking of the ties, which was much more than just the breaking of the ties and more of the breaking of the hearts of a family. So we've spoken about mythology. No matter what we say, no matter how much anyone provides, we hear of people debating, did it really happen? Did it not happen? What is this entire thing about? So let's just go on to a story that we know historically existed, which is of Chanakya. Now, Chanakya, if we all remember our 8th standard history, was a very able strategist. He was an administrator. He was very well known for his planning and how he was basically the reason that Chandragupta Maurya even ascended the throne, according to many historians. And Chanakya was not just a strategist and good at planning and all of those sort of things, but also he was very cunning. And he knew exactly what he wanted. And once he decided what he wanted, nothing could stop him. So that's why he came across Rakshasa. Now, whether Rakshasa is his actual name or, you know, because he's the antagonist of his play, that's the name given to him. It can be debated for hours, but here he is, Rakshasa. He is from an opposing party, and Chanakya wants to get Rakshasa on his side. He wants Rakshasa to be one of the people that joins Chandragupta Maurya. And because Chanakya didn't just want Chandragupta Maurya to rule India, he wanted this to be the greatest empire ever. And he didn't want to do this by simply, you know, territorial conquest and winning war after war. He wanted to do this through strategy. He wanted to get the right minds there. And he wanted to ensure that they would win this thing through politics, through a shatranj almost. And the way he did this, the way he ensured that Rakshasa was on his side, was using mudra or ring or actually signature in one. And this is where the entire play gets its name. It's called Mudra Rakshasa, or the Ring of Rakshas. So what Chanakya does is, the only folly that Rakshasa had ever done before that was to lose his ring to Chanakya's spy. After this, Chanakya weaves a whole web of lies and creates such a world of trouble for him that Rakshasa is deemed helpless. So he starts off by writing a letter and signing it off as Rakshasa and authenticating it by giving his very ring. And he uses this to turn Rakshasa's own family and friends against him. He even goes to the extent of murdering his father and blaming his friend for it, Rakshasa's friend for it. So he will stop at nothing to ensure he can get exactly what he wants. And Chanakya is extremely ruthless. He is cunning. He knows what he wants and he will stop at nothing to get it. But Rakshasa is not like that. Rakshasa has, he is able, he is a smart mind, but he has his own loyalty towards his friends and family. And this actually proves to be his weakness, his undoing. So by the end of it, Chanakya has successfully caused so much to Rakshasa Rakshasa, and he has turned everybody he knows against him, that finally Rakshasa says, fine, I will join. So it ends on a positive note with Rakshasa and Chanakya simply coming together and working under Chandragupta Maurya. And no matter what Chanakya did to him, he does respect him for his capabilities and who he is. And therefore, everything ends well. Now, through this story, when we first hear about Chanakya going, you know, I'm going to do this to this man. I'm going to be ruthless with him. I'm going to stop at nothing. I will kill his father. I will go against his friends and families. I will ensure that I get exactly what I want. You're just like, oh my God, stop. Stop doing this. Why are you putting this man through so much? He did nothing to you. And you feel raudrarasa. You're frustrated. You don't want this man to succeed. But then as you see the plot unfold and you see how beautifully intricate this entire thing is, these little lies and these small manipulations are together coming together and basically forming this weave to sort of almost beautifully trap Rakshasa into it. It's like a spider's web, you know, like you know that the spider's web is there so that it can catch its prey, but it's so ornately made that sometimes you can't stop but feel like this is nature at its best. So you feel a sense of marvel towards it. You feel the adbhuta rasa. That's what the story brings about in you. And at some point, you know, when you're going through the entire story and you hear about all these little trials and tribulations they go through and how, you know, Rakshasa is trying to stay ahead of him and all these sorts of things are happening. And by the end of it, Rakshasa is like, bhai, ko maaf kar de, I will join you. You can't help but laugh. You simply are like, wow, I can't believe you did that, you sick man. And that is the Hasyarasa. So that is what the entire story of Mudra Rakshasa or the ring of Rakshasa is all about, or the sign of Rakshasa is all about. It's about how you use a simple small story device and bring everything together to work for you. Now, some technicalities of this. The sets of very interesting part of this play, in fact, is that the sets of this is mainly Chanakya's home and Rakshasa's home. The entire just alternating between these two. And it's just a back and forth of how Rakshasa and Chanakya are both trying to figure out what the person's next step is going to be, what they're going to do next, and kind of outdo them and do better than them and you know, stay ahead at all times. So that's what the entire thing is about. And you know, that's the whole beauty of it, that the Natyashastra gives that sort of stage direction. It says that, you know, no matter whether, so it says that your stage can be circular, it can be triangular, it can be rectangular, it can be square. It literally provides for everything. It gives you average dimensions. It allows for all of that. And the reason it does so is because with keen stage directions, it can ensure that the required effect is there on people. And that's the entire idea of it. It's just recommendations. It even gives suggestions of who the ideal audience member is, who the ideal performer is. And it's not to say you can't attend it or you can't perform if you don't meet these specifications. It's just to say that if you are in this zone where you are this sort of person, or this is the stage height difference, or this is the distance between the performer and the audience, the desired effect of the Natya will be felt. So say if I was going through the Urubhanga, the first play that we went through, I wouldn't want to see that at my level because I'm not a warrior. I'm not indulging, you know, chit-chatting with Krishna about how to kill Duryodhana. I want that sense of awe. I want to see it at a level higher than my eye level. I want that sense of sort of otherworldliness that the height of a stage can provide. Those are the sort of deals that the Natyashastra does provide to elevate the performance for both the performer and the audience member. So that was our historical drama. Now we've spoken about mythology, we've spoken about historical drama. Let's talk about a common man story. Here enter Charudatta. Looks like quite a common man, doesn't he? So Charudatta is this extremely generous, extremely kind-hearted guy who lives in Ujjaini. He's almost too kind-hearted for his own good because he gives away everything that he has to anybody who asks for it, which has rendered him poor. And he, despite having a wife and child, is in love with Vasantasena, who is a court dancer. Now, you have to remember, these were times when polygamy was around. So let's start it with our 2020 lens. And Vasantasena and Charudatta are in love. Vasantasena is rich. She is beautiful. Everybody knows her. She's very famous in Ujjaini. And she is very infatuated with Charudatta herself. It's a beautiful romance that starts with a chance encounter, and she seeks shelter from him, and they sort of start this flirtatious romance, and it just buds very naturally, and it's really encouraging to watch. And not only this, Vasantha Sena is also extremely kind and affectionate towards Charudatta's son. So what you see here is a clay cart, which is where the entire play gets its name. It's called Mritchakatika, which literally translates to clay cart. Now, Charudatta's son has a clay cart and his neighbors have gold carts. So he is extremely sad and he is crying and he is inconsolable. And Vasantha Sena is about to go meet Charudatta when she chances upon him. And she feels so bad for the child who's crying so because he is poor that she literally takes all of her jewelry and fills the toy clay cart with it, saying, "Here you go. Now it's priceless." So we get that sort of affection that she has for his family as well, you know, and we're rooting for the lead couple to be together. But that's when the Pallava dynasty comes in. And the Pallava dynasty has a lot of problems with this plot. So firstly, there is a tyrant king who is running a very authoritarian government, and it has made people extremely unhappy, and they just want him to go. And also the people in his kingdom, in his palace itself, aren't the nicest either. So here is where our antagonist Samsthanaka comes in. Samsthanaka wants to woo Vasantha Sena, and he wants her by hook or crook. Vasantha Sena is not interested in him at all, but Samsthanaka continues to harass her. And even worse, he gets very annoyed how she's, you know, in love with Charudatta, because Charudatta is a simpleton compared to him. So he's like, "I'm not only going to break them up, I'm going to kill her." And he means it very literally. So he goes ahead, he strangles Vasantha Sena, and he drags her body to court. And he says, "Charudatta is the one who did this." And Charudatta says, "No, I was in love with her, I would never do this." But nobody's listening to him because he has a toy clay cart full of her jewelry, and she was to meet him at that time anyway. So people have proven that he's guilty, and he's ready. Now, before we go ahead with this part, let's look at a very interesting story device, which is jewelry. Now, jewelry in this time in Ujjaini is extremely important. It is important to prove how rich you are. It was important to appease a child. It was important also in a very interesting minor plot where Vasantha Sena has given some of her jewelry to Charudatta, and somebody steals it from him and gives it to Vasantha Sena, saying, use this as the price of freedom so that you can free your slave. Again, a time when slavery was acceptable. So Vasantha Sena realizes, she recognizes that this is her jewelry. She has a slave and confidant for whom this jewelry is being provided to her. She recognizes that it's hers, but she still lets her go because she doesn't want to keep her slave against their wishes. And the person who's stolen it for her has done it out of an act of control because he is in love with her. So we see jewelry as being a price for someone's freedom. It's a way to realize whether somebody's rich or not. It's a way to adorn yourself, to show that you're in love, that you want adoration. It's also, in this case, a way to show whether somebody's innocent or guilty, because that's the only thing they have to go by. So back to the story, Charudatta is ready to be executed. Vasantha Sena comes in. Yes, Vasantha Sena comes in, and she says, "This man is not guilty, stop." Now, what actually happened is the body of the dancer that was dragged into court was somebody else. Samsthanaka did try to strangle her, but a Buddhist monk came in and saved her. Again, very telling of the landscapes of those times that there was a Buddhist monk who came to save her. She has been saved. She comes to court and she gives her witness. She says, "This man is in love with me. He has done nothing wrong." And she gives her testimony against Samsthanaka. Suddenly at this time, the dynasty is overturned and the king is completely powerless, and a new ruler, an able ruler, comes up and he decides to take over. So the sort of political landscape and is completely shaped by the story as well. So the new ruler takes over, he hears her out, he sentences Samsthanaka, and Charudatta is given a position in the court that is very respectable because he realizes how kind the man is. And Charudatta, Vasantha Sena, and his wife go away happily, proclaiming themselves as a family. So that is the entire story of Charudatta. Now, first, when we see Charudatta and Vasantasena in love, and you see how sweet and simple their romance is, and how they're okay with they you know they dress up for each other. They want that adoration from the other person. When you're in love, you shower gifts and love upon the other person. You want admiration from them. You see that flirtatious romance blooming. That is the Shringara Rasa. And then cut to when Samsthanaka is treating Vasantasena. So it's shown in a lot of detail. Samsthanaka is asking his henchmen to kill her. They say they won't do it. So he says, fine, I'll do it myself. He literally takes his bare hands and he strangles her and completely renders her lifeless. And then he drags a body to the court. And then the court is not willing to accept Charudatta's testimony. And they're saying that, no, this is wrong. What you have done is why Vasantasena is dead today. And they're not willing to listen to him. And suddenly you're filled with so much fear because you feel how helpless a woman would feel in this world. And you feel how absolutely small you are in front of such an authoritarian government, in front of a king who just has no place for justice. And you have this fear and you almost want it all to end and you hope that's not what's going to play out. That is the Bhayanaka Rasa. That is what it fills you up with. That was the story of Mrichakatika, which is a clay cart. And it is a story about how simple romances can actually be tied in with a lot larger things. So that ends all the stories I wanted to take you guys through today. One thing that I will say as a closing note is that if anything, I want you to take away the fact that Natyashastra is not for a specific time period or a specific sort of representation. What I'm trying to say is we saw a story of mythology, we saw a historical story, we saw a story of a common man like you and I. So basically what the Natyashastra says is that no matter who you are, what your purpose is, you can be represented. You have a place in Natya. Today, our classical dances, our classical music has become all about, worship and divinity. It's become about religion. But that wasn't the essence of Natya to begin with at all. It was only to showcase life in a way that gives people purpose. So that's what I want you guys to remember when you're going through this entire process of studying the Natyashastra in detail. And I really hope you guys had fun despite the new technical glitch. That's about it. I think let's open to questions now. I see a lot of stuff on the chat. 30 messages. You guys are extremely curious. So where do we start with? Anybody who's put their questions on the chat but would rather speak up and talk about it themselves, that would be completely all right with me. Otherwise, I will just refer to the chat. Okay, so I'm just going to go through the latest question that came in from Anupriya, actually. So if the essence of Natyashastra was that you can be represented, was the same inclusivity offered to the actors? Interestingly, yes. In fact, the way that Natyashastra was implemented at a large scale was through a Shudra. It was done through somebody called Nahusha, and he was a Shudra. In fact, a lot of historians and a lot of people who have read the Natyashastra even say that they want to, that is probably the origin of how Devadasis went on to practice Natya, practice dance. So although there are a lot of angles to that theory, people do believe that that is why it became part of the Devi tradition at all. So it is actually very, very inclusive in the gender, in the way, the kind of person you are, what walk of life you're from. So yeah, very happy to tell you that that is actually. Just wanted to share, I just remembered the name. There is a book called Ajaya by Ananda Neelakantan that tells the story from Duryodhana's perspective, if anyone is interested. And Anupriya, you have also said the same thing. Ajaya, the role of, yes. Those are actually... Shiva, would you like to... I'm just going to mute you. There's a lot of disturbance in your background. Yeah. Okay, perfect. Yeah. So, the original play called Urubhanga was actually written by Bhasa, and Ajay is known to be based on that play. And what is interesting about Urubhanga as well is that it actually goes against a lot of the technicalities mentioned in the Natyashastra. The Natyashastra says you need to have a protagonist, an antagonist, and some story devices to further the plot. And it also says that the protagonist will always get there happily ever after. There is never a tragedy. But this is why it's very interesting to study this book. It's that none of these are rules. They are recommendations, they're suggestions, and it's best if you abide by them. But nobody's stopping you from going against them and having your own interpretation. So Bhasa wrote a lot of mythological plays. He had a lot of different perspectives. I believe he's written 6 on the Mahabharata and 4 on the Ramayana. And nobody questions his authority, even though he's not going by exactly what the Natyashastra is saying. Because the Natyashastra is a book that allows you to experiment in that way. And there are critics who sort of say that, Duryodhana getting his salvation is his happily ever after. But a lot of people do see the hero himself dying sort of takes away from that. So two sides to the coin, but that is one way of looking at it as well. What else do we have here? I remember when I read about this in the Amar Chitra Katha, Gandhari screamed about Krishna and Bhima for bringing kids to Dhamma, saying that the fans they got in their palace are replaced by vultures, their comfortable beds replaced by barren ground, their beautiful queens all disheveled. With this, Gandhari defies Krishna for being the epitome of compassion. Very interesting observation and great memory, Ananya Mishra, for bringing that up. I'm so glad you can make it again. And yes, this is true. Amar Chitra Katha actually has a lot of interesting ways of bringing this sort of thing to the people, almost like a modern day small way of implementing the Natyashastra.
I was just going to say how it puts the Natyashastra in, it delivers the Natyashastra to everybody and anybody.
Yeah, definitely. I'm so right about that. Rami says, extremely informative. Thank you so much. Okay, I don't see any other questions. Anybody else who has questions before we go, you can just unmute yourselves and speak, or you can put it in the chat. Anything is all right. Anybody? I'm going to wait for a minute for those of you who are shy. And
so, can I go have a go at it, Anaga?
Yeah, sure, definitely.
All right. Okay. So I think wonderful session, very beautifully done, very beautifully explained. And the examples and the stories that you shared were like amazing. And I kind of like know about them. You shared them earlier with us. And but hearing it today, of course, made a lot of difference because it was presented in the most beautiful way. What I think, I would like to know is that, what is your take on this contemporary style that is coming into Natyashastra and how people are now interpreting? Do you kind of agree with that, or do you think there are gaps or loopholes there, or does it permit it,
Thank you for asking such a controversial question. I would expect nothing less. I assume you mean contemporary style of dances or contemporary style of dramas that have come in right now. So what I will say is that if you go back to the essence or the roots of Natyashastra itself, there nowhere does it say that this cannot be done. It doesn't say, so most people when they argue, most people who are a little more, who have a very set idea of how dance and drama are perceived, they will argue that the Natyashastra doesn't allow you. It'll say that the Natyashastra has never said that you can do this. But what they forget is that the Natyashastra also never said you can't do it. So although obviously at the time that the Natyashastra was written, nobody expected Bollywood to be a thing. Nobody expected, all different sort of dances to be a thing. But I think that is the sort of it is sort of holding its hand out to say, you can do that if you want. What you make of it, what your purpose is of doing it, is completely up to you. Whether your purpose aligns with with the original people who have studied the Shastra or written the Natya Shastra, you know, the purposes may not align. But just by virtue of this being your purpose, yes, you are allowed to do it. And the thing is, this is something I always say. And the reason all my promos had, you don't have to answer, or it's not just about Bharatanatyam, is because that, thanks Shraddha, it always is nice to get that validation from a dancer. She's also a fellow Bharatanatyam dancer. So the fact that she agrees with me is great to know. One thing that I will say is that the reason I was saying that you know, Bharatanatyam is not a necessary part of, it does not have to be a necessary part of your life if you want to attend this, is because Bharatanatyam as we know it today is not based on the Natya Shastra completely. In fact, it details Margi and Deshi forms of dances. And there are dance forms that are older than the Natya Shastra. There are dance forms that originated at the exact time of the Natya Shastra. And there is a possibility that there was a version of Bharatanatyam that did exist during that time. But the version we perform today is not old at all. It is actually one of the most recent forms of dance that India has.
Okay.
Because that is true, and because that openness there when we came up with Bharatanatyam, I think that openness can be provided to anything, any form of that. So, yeah.
I have a follow-up question to Ruchi's question only. I just sort of lost right now. So, Raghav, the beautiful session. I mean, you kind of, you know, captivated the entire through the presentation, especially. I didn't know so many types of rasas. I actually did not. I just know about rasa from the Krishna sort of thing, but that's beautiful. Just the thing that, you said that Natya Shastra does not say you cannot do this. So that's, you know, that's fairly progressive and very inclusive of Natya Shastra. But how does a play get attached to being a part of Natya Shastra? So the plays you mentioned are all within the domain of Natya Shastra. Now, if a new person, you know, a new play comes in, first of all, like, you know, can they claim that they are part of the tradition of Natya Shastra, or is there some sort of an authority body that decides that sort of a thing for them?
Absolutely not. So even if there exists an authority body that claims that we will categorize it or not, does not actually have that authority, because the Natya Shastra doesn't allow for it. In fact, there are some plays by Bhasa, who again is a very, very famous Sanskrit playwright, that people did even before the Natya Shastra. And they say that some of them don't fall into what the Natya Shastra prescribes. And therefore, would you then say that somebody from that time who has put in such beautiful effort and come up with such amazing stories that force you to think beyond the basic narrative given to you, would you say that that doesn't qualify then? And the thing is, I have never seen somebody say that that doesn't qualify for Bhasa, but they will say it for now. In fact, I have Shraddha here. I'm wondering if Vakula is also here. Some of the plays that we have done, which are around hour and a half long, are Sanskrit dramas. They are written by our dance teacher. And he is a scholar in Sanskrit. He is doing his PhD in it. He is very well versed with the subject. And he is also one of the people who taught us the Natya Shastra. He taught us the Natya Shastra. He understands it better than anything we could ever think. And he has written Sanskrit dramas that he identifies with the Natya Shastra very well. He says some of these practices are outdated, or some of these are not relevant, or some things can be included, some things cannot. He respects, he recognizes that, but he still says that his play is rooted in the Natya Shastra. So there is no specific body, no specific person, unless, you know, Brahma himself comes down and tells you that. There is nobody who is going to tell you you can or cannot classify a play as part of it at all.
So, I have another thing I want to ask, okay? So now you're talking about dancers, and you're talking about training, and you're talking about all those things. But, you know, not everybody kind of like has time or access to, you know, teachers who can. What do you think is the contemporary take on Natya Shastra? I mean, like, how can we bring it to our own daily lives? Like, what is the application, you know, in now's time?
So one thing that I did say in the beginning was that don't do your duty, perform your duty, right? So the reason I said that was because obviously that is not the most literal way of doing it, but in the smallest way possible, if you're not a person of arts, if you're not a person who, you know, gets up and dances, if you're not a singer, if you're not interested in all those things and you don't attend it, or you don't have the resources, like you said, the smallest way in which you could really be in keeping with the Natya Shastra or embody what it means would be for you to be able to say that I am fulfilling my dharma in the truest way possible. I am doing it in the passion, the most passionate way that I can. I'm emotional about it because I care about it. And it is to the point where if tomorrow somebody were to write a play about me, or if somebody were to ask me to do a natya for something that I am doing every day, then I can do it. That's how passionate I am about it. That's how emotional I am about it. That would be the best recommendation I could give.
Okay.
I think you should go back to the first slide that you probably started off with, where you said about the people were chanting the Vedas, but they never connected to it. I think you can look at some takeaway over there. Can you just, because we missed that slide also. Can you go through that, and then you could run through that if there, it makes sense for a takeaway over there.
Yeah, sure.
The second one, yeah. No. Just before this.
This is the slide. That is my mom, by the way.
So can you tell us what is the purpose of Natya Shastra coming in at all? What was missing in the first part? Okay. When people were
Basically, what I was trying to detail. So even when we talk about the Vedas and we have this sort of, we associate it with the sort of close-mindedness or not being available to everybody, and which is something that I realize has come to be associated with a lot of forms of dance and music as well, and drama for that matter. I think what we must realize is that learnings are learnings, reflections are reflections, and they should be open to everybody. Whoever wants to be part of it, whoever wishes to imbibe it in themselves, at least in an emotional way, at least in a way that is personal to you, not institutionalized, but personal to you, is allowed to do that, is allowed to partake in that. So that's probably what I would say about that. I'm just going to switch off the screen share, guys. I just wanted to, I need to see all of the questions.
Just wanted to add something with respect to relevance of Natya Shastra with the current day, right? The question that you had. Actually, it's been, many people have wrote about it also, that the current day's Indian cinema is very much related to Natya Shastra. Actually, the vrittis that Natya Shastras talk about, the Aryabhati, the Kaishiki vritti, right? And all these vrittis are also associated with regions, right? The different regions, east, west, north, and south. And even now we see that, you know, from the different regions in India, right? You always associate, a Bengali or a Malayalam movie to the art side. And then we have the northern side is more associated with, big sets, Sanjay Bansali type, right? Sanjay Leela Bansali type. So it's very, the way Natya Shastra has divided the different styles of movies to the different regions of India, it's still relevant and still present in present day Indian cinema. So I just wanted to add that for...
Definitely. In fact...
How relevant it is even now.
Adding on to what you said,
the Indian movie makers are not reading Natya Shastra, but still it's there in the blood. It's there in the legacy, right?
Yeah. That's the beauty of this entire text, that it's not like some, a fancy thing that, only one person thought of and you can't implement. It's something that you very innately will do if you are really fulfilling the purpose of why you are indulging in this form of art.
As Varsha rightly pointed out, I think we can add here that, whatever connects to emotions, whether it is the contemporary movies or, the Vedas were not able to bring the change or connect to the emotions, that is timeless and it is universal in itself. So that is why it is always going to be contemporary. It is going to be timeless and it is universal.
Adding on to that, I would also like to mention that it's not just movies and it's not just one or two forms of dance or cinema. Even Varsha herself, she is involved in a very interesting way of bringing Natya out of its sort of, you know, restricted Bharatanatyam way of doing things and taking it out to the kids. So I've heard some very interesting ideas of how she's using dance as a way of educating children as well. If you want, Varsha, quickly in a minute, I think you'd be a better judge of that and you'd be able to speak about it a lot better than I am. You're on mute.
Yeah. So, I work on this art education program. So, wherein I realized that using Natya as a tool, right? So, we can teach math, we can teach science, we can teach social, and it's very reachable for all the kids, right? So, for instance, so recently I've been doing something like using Bharatanatyam to teach LCM. Right. So the concept of talam and multiples and actual natyam, literally if you just give beats and say takadimi and they're dancing it, and how they're able to relate to it because of the interesting link. Because so basically Natya Shastra, it kind of it comes to a point where we say that all fields are related, be it arts or science. They are never different. Like if you say, for instance, in the name itself, Natyam, we associate something with arts, but Shastra is science, right? Shastra literally means science. Yeah. So it's like a beautiful marriage between arts and science. That's what I would say. That's my take on that. And one more interesting thing that Natya Shastra ends with a note that, according to the different periods, I mean, the times we live in, we generally associate tradition with very rigidity, right? But it says that it allows creativity, just like Anaga was saying. They are just guidelines for you to follow, but you're allowed to change it according to the times, right? Practicing auchityam. Auchityam is seeing what is correct, you know, for a crowd, if you're performing for a younger crowd, right? What is appropriate? Maybe you would not do something if you're dancing for 10-year-olds, don't dance something like a Nayika subject or something too much in Shringaram. So practice auchityam, that is, use your discretion to decide what is appropriate for the audience, but you are allowed to change according to times. So I think that's a very beautiful way of saying that there is creativity in tradition.
For sure. That is so true. And that is, in fact, one of the final, the thesis that I had written for this specific course that I did on the Natya Shastra was about the timelessness and the universality of art itself. And that is what I think the Natya Shastra embodies in the I see two last questions. I'm going to take those really quickly and then we will wrap this up. One I have from Ananya Mishra, who's asking me, do you think the evolution of Carnatic music will affect Bharatanatyam? Definitely. As Bharatanatyam is practiced today, it is done most of the time, at least by traditionalists on Carnatic music. So if Carnatic music evolves in a different way. So for example, right now I see Indian Raga doing some very interesting things with Carnatic music. They stick to the ragas, they stick to the talas that Carnatic music asks for. They also stick to even agam, like so many different modern fusion bands are coming up with different versions of old songs or different ways of expressing Carnatic music, and immediately we see it picked up by Bharatanatyam and people have their own renditions of it as well. So it'll definitely affect, they're completely codependent.
How we perform to an Uttukadu Venkata Subbaiya Kriti, or how we perform to a Lalgudi Jayaraman Tillana or a Kriti, and or how we perform to a Mahesh Raghavan remix, they're all very different styles of, you know what I mean? So I was saying how we perform to an Uttukudu Venkata Subbaiya Kriti, and how we perform to a Lalgudi Jayaraman Tillana, and how we perform to a Mahesh Raghavan remix, they're all different styles. Raghavan styles, you'll see a lot of freestyling as well. You'll see a lot of fusion. You'll see mixing, matching.
the openness that one provides sort of links into the other. I think that that's a very interesting observation to make. It is very true.
While in a Subhaya Griti, you will see a lot of Anga Shuddhi. Anga Shuddhi will be the priority in the
order. If we were to talk about this, I feel like this is going into a realm that everybody else is just like, huh, what are you saying? So there is this song called Krishna Ni Vegane Baro, which is Telugu. It's a language even I don't understand. So this has nothing to do with Bharatnatyam or Carnatic music. Anirudh, this is not your realm to show off. This is the song basically is saying, Krishna, you're beautiful, you lovely little child, please come. And there is so much emotion in the way that it is written and in the way that it is sung that when somebody dances on it, they very automatically show that emotion, no matter what style of dance you are doing, whether you're doing a purely Bharatnatyam piece or not, you show that emotion because of the music and you feel it. Even though I don't understand word for word what it means, when somebody told me that this is the gist of it, I knew exactly what to do with it, because that's how beautiful music is and how it transcends things. And that's what the Natya Shastra says, that use Natya to transcend away from or transcend the boundaries that you have created by your simple sort of blinders put way of life. Use it to transcend and reach out to people and reach out to yourself within yourself as well. And converse to that, when you take up like a tilana, which is one of the things that Ananya mentioned, tilana is basically something that is very upbeat. It is dependent on steps, or even jati or alaripu, it is very dependent on steps, and there is less emotion there. It's more for the nritya form of dance that I spoke about.
That's so, more about the jatisvarams and the alaripus, right?
Yeah, mainly for the jatisvarams and alaripus, but the modern rendition of tilana has now become in terms of beats as well. But the idea is that the story then becomes about the beats and the tempos that the Natya Shastra is asking you to give into. And it says, do the tandava. It's not saying show anger, but it's saying if you did want to show that kind of emotion, you can. You know, that's what it's about. And that's how music also is sort of shaping that idea that sort of surrounds it.
There is one last question I want to ask. Okay, one more question I have. Okay,
sure.
Because
sure.
I work a lot in the field of expressive arts, and theater and dance and expression becomes one of the very important parts of that. And we see Russian ballet, we see, all sorts of even South American ballroom dancing and all those come into that field of, helping people express themselves. And that's a very modern take on a very therapeutic expression somewhere. Where do you think our Indian dance forms, which are amazingly expressive, and, we talk about Navrasas and how do they come into that application, and how can we actually bring it to people in the most therapeutic way?
So very rightly, Viji Ravi was also saying, my mother, please don't kill me for saying your name. What she was saying was also essentially in the realm of this, that, emotion and expression is something that should reach out to the people, irrespective of the form of Natya that you are involved in. Whether it's South American ballroom dancing, whether it's Bharatanatyam, whether it's theater with dialogues and no poetry, or theater which is just musicals like La La Land or something like that. It's about this ability to emote, and I think that's what therapy also is all about, right? It's about allowing people to express themselves, feel safe in that expression, and feel like it's okay to emote and get in touch with those emotions. So I think in the essence, it already is saying that, art can be a great way to, perform that sort of therapy at all. It's already right there, and we just have to take it out and give it to the people, which I think Cobalt Blue Foundation is doing a very good job with. They're doing this 21-day art challenge. They got into different colors, they did patterns, I remember this one thing, one that I'd attended, which Ruchi had done, where she was literally using an onion sliced in half, and she was making a mandala out of it. Like, that's all. It was just like amla being made out of onion stamps like that when you dip it in paint.
No. So I always find that this beautiful expression, and I feel that people, you know, and of course we have a lot of dancers here and a lot of young people. So I think, I feel that, you know, you should be using this to help people with therapy, you know, with people with rehabilitation, you know, in expression, because a lot of people would benefit from this whole thing, you know, because see, Westerners are doing it, you know, a lot of them are using their dance forms and trans. So I think you could be the next movement who could be, you know, using it, the dance as therapy, you know. Especially these traditional beautiful dance forms, you know. So it's just an idea I'm throwing at everybody right now. You know?
Dance therapy was a thing a few years ago. I mean, somebody called Uma Das, she used to work with human trafficking victims. She used to help human trafficking victims and survivors get through their trauma through dance.
I understand that is all happening. What I'm saying is, are we using our traditional dance forms somewhere in the therapy? You know, that is not happening, you know. So I know dance therapy is happening and therapeutic dancing is happening, but are we taking these traditional forms and these pure expressions out there for people to kind of express themselves and, you know, rehabilitate and feel better about, you know, the entire situation? So
there is a Rasa Foundation in Chennai run by Ambika Kamesh, where she is, you know, exclusively, I mean, using Bharatanatyam as a tool for helping out the so-called special children, right? So, I mean,
very nice.
And it's so beautiful. It's actually a therapy for us to see those children dance. So it's very beautiful. You can Google it up. And of course,
I will.
Yeah, there is a lot of scope for therapy through Bharatanatyam, definitely.
Yes. Yes.
And another example, I remember one NGO has used some of the mudras of dance for giving a little bit of, like, you know, they have tried for bringing, for the helping the people who cannot speak.
Sign language.
So because with the sign language is not restricted only to a particular language. Probably the sign language which is used
in the most universal.
Universal. So they experimented with it, but still it is still under consideration. So these kind of, as you're saying very rightly, it can be used for multiple purposes. And Varsha is using it for teaching math.
So I think not taking the spotlight from Anaga now, let her finish and let her close the session. Thank you very much, guys. It was beautiful. Thank you for answering. I think everybody pitched in to answer, Anaga, for you. And it's beautiful. Good crowd. I think you should finish the session now.
Yeah, sure. Definitely. Thank you so much for all of you for joining me today, and bigger thank you for letting me know that my screen was not changing, so I could fix that before I went through 1 hour of just rambling. So thanks a lot for that. I see a lot of private messages also telling me, hey, change the slide. So thank you so much for taking the time. It was great to discuss this with all of you, and it was a lot of fun to sort of decode a text like this with such an interactive audience. And I'm really hoping that you know, we can start a conversation using this, and you feel more encouraged and more welcome towards the world of Natya Shastra, and don't think that it is for it is a bygone, or it is for a specific sect of people only. It is for everybody, and it was great to be here. Also, shout out to Cobalt Blue Foundation for giving me this platform to talk about a subject I'm so passionate about. They have a month-long series called the India Unfolded Event Series, where they're doing different sort of beautiful virtual story walks. They're like helping you visit different temples virtually. They're talking about different stories, mythologies. It's really beautifully done. And I believe we have Anupriya with us here today. This Friday, he has a session coming up as well to do with the Great Deluge. So Anupriya, do you want to take a minute to talk about it really quickly?
Sure, Anaga. Thanks. Again, like, you know, really for a fascinating session. And for some people like me who don't know the D of dancing, I kind of just feel like, you know, it was part of a conversation that really, you know, enlightened me a lot. So I am doing a session on Friday on the Great Deluge. So many of us know about the flood myths, right? We know we've heard of the stories, the Noah's Ark and all. And it's always like the gateway drug for, you know, any mythologist to, like, you know, finally jump into this thing that, hey, all the stories seem similar. So I'm going to be talking about the stories, three of them, from the Babylonian myth, the Gilgamesh story, the Noah story, and the Quranic story of Manu and Matsya. So please do join in. It's at Friday around 9 p.m. Okay. So yeah. Thanks.
Thank you very much, and thank you everybody for joining today's session at Cobalt Blue Foundation with Anaga, Ravi, and Anupriya. And her family is clapping. We should also give her a big round of clap.
Oh, definitely.
Okay.
Is there a mudra for, like, you know, saying thank you?
Yes, you know, and well, I think the best example for me, for Natya Shastra, you know, is in the physical form. I see at the Delhi International Airport, they have done these mudras at the you know, when you come to India, they have these Natya Shastra mudras there as well. And thank you for touching upon.
There's also a mural of the Natya Shastra, a mural inspired by the Natya Shastra at Vashi Station.
So it's wonderful that somehow, you know, the current governments are touching upon it in a bit, and I hope it comes from this small subculture and becomes mainstream. It's a beautiful way of looking at life. The four ashrams of life, dharam, earth, kam, moksha, can be lived very beautifully through Natya Shastra and Natya Shudra. And thank you everyone for giving us your dinner time. I think everybody must be hungry, or maybe a lot of people were eating as well, which is great. But Anaga must be hungry. I think she needs to eat. Join us for our next session. We are having a lot of sessions coming up. Check out our website, cobaltbluefoundation.com, for more. And see you again. Thank you once again, and namaskar.
Thank you so much, guys. Good night.
Good night.
Good night.
Bye.